Viewpoint is made possible by the generous financial support from the Greenlight Fund. For more information, call 305-424-4191. Hello, I'm Henry Mack, and welcome to another special edition of Viewpoint Navigating Ethics. Zika, dengue fever, chikungunya, these are just some of the diseases putting the public on edge as global travel brings more and more foreign-borne illnesses to South Florida's door. The emergence of these infectious diseases present unprecedented challenges for South Florida's public health officials, not to mention emergency rooms and doctor's offices across the region. From the allocation of resources to patient care and communicating these risks, how exactly do hospitals navigate the ethics of public health emergencies? And what should be the role of state and local governments? We welcome Ken Goodman, director of the Institute for Bioethics and Health Policy at the University of Miami. Ken is also the co-director of the UM Ethics Program. Dr. Marie Florent-Carre, Director of Rural and Urban Underserved Medicine and Assistant Professor of Family Medicine and Public Health at Nova Southeastern University's College of Osteopathic Medicine, and Kimarie Stratos, Senior Vice President, General Counsel, and Chief Privacy Officer at Memorial Healthcare System. Thanks for taking the time. Really, really excited about this topic, especially in light of Zika, Ebola, and some other sort of really, really concerning public health epidemics and infectious diseases. I guess the first question is, what sort of precipitated this conversation is the extent to which our hospitals and doctor's offices are prepared. And if confronted with a scarcity of resources, how exactly do doctors and hospitals sort of make decisions about who to treat, when to treat, how to treat, et cetera? So I think that's sort of the most meatiest ethical debate or issue here. I don't know, Ken, do you want to kick it off?
Sure. In fact, for the good news in South Florida, at least, is we have a pretty solid track record of hospitals collaborating with each other to identify resources, to find out chains of responsibility, who's going to share what with whom when it's necessary. And that's good news. It's like there's this wonderful cartoon of these two guys walking down the street, and it's raining and sleeting and snowing, and the wind's blowing sideways. And one turns to the other and says, every year we get this unpredictable weather. Sooner or later, we're going to figure out that there are patterns here. And South Florida began preparing with some intensity, along with everybody else in the country, back during the influenza pandemic fears more than a decade ago. That built a really good network of hospitals collaborating with each other in our region.
Interesting. So I can't believe that there's that large-scale institutional collaboration.
Well, they're at least communicating. I mean, one of the issues, of course, is what resources are available, how much will they actually share, what can you share? And what does it need to be shared? I mean, sometimes it's just medicines, sometimes it could be ventilators. And the current challenge we're facing with Zika might even be expertise that we're sharing. Public health is not a good basis on which to compete. It's a good basis on which to cooperate.
Sure. Nice point, very optimistic point. And I don't mean to like frame the discussion around fear of,
it was hopeful
of the fact
optimistic.
Of there may be a scarcity of resources with potential, alarming diseases here. But what are the ethical issues embedded in managing public health emergencies? Maybe I'll go to the lawyer of the group here. Even though you don't strictly, deal with ethics, but I'm sure there are sort of situations here that we can sort of bring out for the public to reflect on.
Absolutely. There are ethics really in any clinical decision, because everything about healthcare at the end of the day is allocation of resources. It's a finite resource, whether it's the materials, the actual human resource, et cetera. So clinicians make finite decisions every day at a higher level. The administrators at hospitals make decisions about programs, funding, et cetera. Mm-hmm. And from a policy systemic level, at the top, they make decisions about resource allocation. So this is just, I think, in an emergency situation, a different resource allocation in terms of how they make decisions.
So that's what I want to know. Like, what criteria do hospital administrators and physicians use to determine who gets what and when, and why patient X is more deserving of medicine B than patient Y is, right?
So it usually, as you drill down to patient X and patient Y, doesn't usually get at least an administrative level or a policy level down to patient X or patient Y per se. Occasionally, I mean, you saw that with the hepatitis C drug that was developed recently in managed care companies and so on, because that was $80,000 drug or a dosage, basically, in the United States anyway, mm-hmm. ethically, not in other countries. That brings up a whole different issue. But is that something a managed care company is going to pay for or not? So you have those kind of decisions at the patient level. But then at the higher level, are you going to develop a bone marrow transplant program, or are you going to put your money on, you know, prenatal care? I mean, are you going to do preventative care? Are you going to take the person? And Ken can speak to this. We in South Florida have actually collaborated greatly in the pediatric arena in trying to create a futility policy, because should you throw resources at someone that doesn't have an opportunity to really live a life versus those resources going to vaccinating children? Or I know that's controversial too.
Yeah, but you sort of sound like the death panel.
Yeah, well, that's an old name we don't use anymore.
Well, no, they're life panels. In fact, if I might briefly, there was a shortage of a pediatric influenza vaccine, a Prevnar, and there just wasn't enough. The state didn't prepare enough, producing a situation for Florida physicians where they were only allowed to give the state vaccine to patients who were Medicaid eligible, but the insurance patients were able to get the vaccine from the refrigerator that had been stocked by the industry. We managed that in some cases by pediatricians reaching into their own pockets and paying for the vaccine. But that's because Tallahassee could not do its duty in terms of providing resources that would benefit many people. Vaccine is for one person that helps the community.
I get the point, and you know, I was obviously being facetious with the death panel comment, but you know, that's sort of like what I wanted to take this opportunity to do, was to reflect on sort of the underlying ethical issues that are presented as a result of Zika and these infectious diseases that we may still confront, right? Dr. Marie, you have a history serving or researching underserved populations, whom I would imagine are not properly attended to here.
And I would say, in terms of the underserved, I had the opportunity to work in a rural community, migrant worker population in Belgrade, Florida.
Mm-hmm. And during the AIDS epidemic?
They gave me not during the AIDS epidemic, more, I would say, recently. However, I learned from the population about the history mm-hmm. of, during the time of the AIDS epidemic, how they really dealt with pretty much this new emerging disease that at the time scientists, we did not know how it was being transmitted. When AIDS came, a lot of patients were dying. We had a lot of questions. There was a lot of fear as a whole in the world, in the United States. And as we know, there were different, you know, epidemiologically, we had to, as the facts were coming in and scientists and researchers were doing their, you know, presenting the information to the public, it really dealt with stigmatization because we really didn't know what was going on. So with the Belgrade population, I learned from them that there was some stigma as a result of AIDS. It was really the population where the first cases of heterosexual transmission were actually found in the United States. Was in that you know, small town. However, there was a scare from one of my patients that said mosquitoes. They thought actually at the time that it was being, you know, transmitted by mosquitoes. Mm-hmm. And we had athletes that really had a problem going even to a nearby county to play. So although these are anecdotal stories, but during the time of an emerging disease, when patients are dying, such as in the AIDS cases or Ebola, where really we have more high mortality, people have fear. And usually you will find more from the emergency standpoint, let's say, that you're gonna have patients brought in. We had to do the protective equipment gear, the training that the hospitals, a lot of times when you have an emerging threat or even from pandemic or epidemic proportion, our responsibility as administrators, healthcare professionals, is really to educate ourselves, really researchers then to present the facts, to give it the epidemiology so that we could quickly come up with the answers, the diagnoses, and also treatment as quickly as possible. Right. But in the midst of it, how do we deal with the public? And when you are faced with
That's another interesting ethical question, right? Is when to disclose, what to disclose, how to collect the data itself too, and whether or not patient privacy is violated as a result of this potential large-scale scale collaboration between hospitals. I mean, mm-hmm. when you said that, I thought of what we discussed earlier on in the previous episode, data sharing, and then my privacy being violated as a result. But that aside, maybe to Kimarie too. You know what are sort of the criteria by which a hospital sort of judges when to disclose, what to disclose, and how to disclose.
So under HIPAA, right. And everybody's familiar with HIPAA,
right.
Hospital's a covered entity, so it has to follow those guidelines, but it can disclose under HIPAA without violating the regulation to a public health authority. So information has to be provided to the CDC with respect to these kind of diseases. And then you are able to talk about the number of cases and what you have. You don't have to identify particular protected health information, which is what's precluded with HIPAA. So it is quite easy to still collaborate, as Ken talked about. And I think there is great collaboration in these sort of things across the board, from the Department of Health. You start out with the State Department down to the local levels. Here, Dade and Broward are definitely collaborating. And then the hospitals all have, we're used to, as Ken pointed out, disaster teams. I mean, in fact, we live in Hurricane Alley, so some of this, you go into incident response, you're used to pulling groups of interdisciplinary folks together, and you'll absolutely have the immunologists on there, but you'll have the regulatory affairs people, you'll have the nurses that on the floor, the OBGYNs in this case, so, are very important.
So,
the
Ken, what are some of the juicy ethical issues here with communication and disclosure, right?
Communication and disclosure to people who are inclined to be fearful, mm-hmm. who tend to lack what some of our colleagues have come to call health literacy. There's a lot of magical thinking, and we've actually seen some of it exploited for political purposes. When you make people fearful, they make irrational decisions. Florida is a beautiful example because of hurricanes. How do you predict the course of a risk? The risk is always there, but what neighborhoods, what communities do you warn of Zika? Where do you put the mosquito traps? How do you tell which communities need to evacuate before the storm? And if you're a public health official, or with the National Hurricane Center, if you do it too early or too late or too far north or too far south, that's a problem.
So point in case, like Miami Herald suing, to get the information about where the Zika traps are held. Right, we want to know where this is and what's happening here.
We want to know
everything.
Sure, we do. Whether or not
it might not be in our best interest to know, and so then what are the decision-making sort of ethical criteria by which people decide this stuff?
Right. So this is a great question that goes to, I think, one of the most difficult contemporary issues of all, namely, to what extent do we trust our colleagues in public health and government? And I
should we cough to, now or later?
I have not gotten to that point of cynicism where I believe that everything that they do, that our public servants are all venal, corrupt opportunists. I think we all have a lot of colleagues who work really hard for the government. They're good public servants. They take their service seriously and they do a good job. If they say, look, if we start publishing where all the mosquito traps are, then they're going to be vandalized. It's going to produce a false sense of security for people who should be wearing a long sleeve shirt three blocks down the road. In other words, the sense in which we think we can, ordinary people without the knowledge of the epidemiologists and others who are studying this, make fine-grained decisions about what kind of shirt to wear today because you told me where the mosquito trap was, mm-hmm. is caused entirely by a suspicion that I think is unwarranted, which is a feature of our time. So one of the greatest challenges, even it may begin with resource allocation, it may have to do with education. In the context of Zika, it has to do with reducing uncertainty. It took a long time to ramp up the research budget. We reduce uncertainty by learning more. So if that saves lives, then why are we so slow to identify resources to do that research? Now it's flowing through now, and that is some of the research funds are coming from Washington, Atlanta, and Tallahassee, but it could have been earlier.
But, I'm going to challenge you on that for a second. So, governed in the sunshine. Florida has one of the strongest sunshine laws in the country in terms of what the public has the right to know. And while there are exceptions for PHI and many other things in terms of peer review, information, et cetera, the concept of a mosquito trap isn't accepted in general. And so I would argue, and I think there's a real basis for saying, if I'm an individual and my state is looking at something and they've decided this looks like an area that might have Zika, and I'm a woman that might get pregnant, or I'm a man that might, be involved with a woman, or I'm somebody that just could get bitten and therefore accidentally cause someone else to get Zika, I think maybe I have that right to know. And so should the government play big brother in terms of deciding that? I'm not sure.
I'm not sure it's big brother the government's playing.
And
And maybe I'll just like the story about the guy who's looking for his car keys under the light, though. And they say, did you lose your keys here? And I lost them over there. And, well, why are you looking here? And he says, well, the light's better. That there happens to be a trap somewhere is not necessarily a good reason to believe you're at greater or lesser risk. And if you make those decisions every time one new bug is found, it's not a matter of Big Brother. It's a matter of trying to make sure that people get comprehensive information, not the dribs and drabs of uncertainty that tends to follow from these interventions.
And I think the way that the information in terms of from the CDC, in terms of the guidance, as well as the decision to whether it's from the federal, you know, from the CDC down to the state and then county, is that once you identify whether it is a particular area or mosquitoes that were infected, and to really disseminate this information. The challenge is, how do you even say that this county is affected, but yet just all of us in a tri-county area, we work cross-county. So yes, we may say we identify an area, which really is more for stopping the mosquitoes or really eliminating. It's more for mosquito control. And there has been some debate on aerial spraying in terms of nailed, which, you know, had some, you know, important discussion that was done in the communities. Even I saw in South Carolina, there was a lot of bee colonies that one of the articles that I read that, you know, there are people who are in the bee colony, you know, where it's important to the food supply. So that discussion also became important and was put on the table. My point that I'm saying is that it's really what we talk about, the social determinants of health. This week is the American Public Health Association, their annual conference in Denver. And we talk about social determinants of health, really to look at this as a global problem and more than. And as you mentioned, that yes, we're pinpointing a particular area, but does that say just because this area was highlighted as there are mosquitoes that are infected there, that we don't have it across the states? And how long it's going to take for the other states then to have mosquitoes that are infected? So the question is, yes, it not necessarily has to be localized to a particular area, but once that information becomes available, what do we do? Is it a local, or do we contain it? So for containment purposes, if you go and do aerial spraying without telling the community that you're going to do aerial spraying to kill the mosquitoes, and whether that's the most effective we have, but that's what we have currently available. Until we develop better methods, you have to inform the public if you're going to do aerial spraying, where probably they had to discuss the areas without just saying, well, people are sleeping, we're going to spray and kill mosquitoes.
Right. And do we have other alternatives? Because it's the whole GMO mosquito issue, and the issue of, we were talking about this before, the fact that the Keys, the area in the little island in the Keys that was identified as the test case for the GMO mosquitoes in the United States, is going to vote on that in November.
So do you support that? I mean, the idea that individuals get to vote on areas, on technical areas where they have slim understanding, is a great challenge. I mean, we celebrate openness in society, and this is not an argument against openness. It's, do you want to put every public health decision to a public vote?
Right. That's how much do we need to know, and how much do we need to be involved?
And mind
right?
you, if we're really concerned about public health, yeah. we'd stop lurching between emergencies. We'd have more support for maternal fetal health. We'd have better support for pediatrics. We'd have found the resources to do a good job taking care of people who already were sick, as opposed to the transmissible disease du jour, where we get us all excited. If the state of Florida were really wanted to commit itself to the health of populations, it would have identified those, and that's what our colleagues do, is identify social determinants and try and reduce them.
Yeah.
The problem is we tend to be unwilling to write that check.
And one can't, you know, remove politics from the equation here, right? Pivoting back a bit to the resource question, I still kind of want to know, you know, if the zombie apocalypse happens tomorrow, you know, what kind of equipment is available for me? And again, how those determinations are made. You alluded to, Kimarie, at the outset, sort of the decision-making process. I'm still interested, again, in the specific criteria and how benefits and costs are weighed with respect to patients, especially when confronted with a disease like Ebola, right? So that's my first question. Second question is the duty to treat, especially in ERs, right, for clinicians, for nurses and physicians? And to what extent does one forego the duty to treat if confronted with a significant risk to the provider, him or herself? I don't know if we want to go back to the resource question or if we want to just go on with that last one.
Well, so, but they're closely related, right? If we wanted to do the right thing, sometimes that's easy to identify. There's no dilemma. Make sure they're adequate resources. Now, there's sometimes that's easier to say than to do. In some contexts, what we found is that there might an emergency not be enough, or the resource is individual people. So, for Ebola is a good example. If you're going to expose yourself, goes to your point about futility earlier. If you're going to expose yourself to a terrible, fatal disease, and expose yourself, and no one will be able to take care of people, when your patient's going to die anyway. Then that's probably not a good use of that resource. When it comes to, so fast forward.
They themselves make that decision? Does the nurse get to make that decision?
Institutions have
developed policies. Does the doctor do?
There are protocols. Yeah, there are protocols. And there's national guidance on that in terms of if you have, for example, in Orlando when we had the horrible nightclub shooting, you know, the terrorism up there, if you look at the lessons learned at Orlando Regional or talk to them, they went straight to their protocol. They called in all their available trauma surgeons. The CEOs came in, anybody in leadership came in to try to direct things. They triaged immediately. And unfortunately, if somebody was there that looked like they couldn't be saved at all, that person didn't get prioritized. It was about so one of the very first thing is if this person can't be saved and there's a limited resources and there's only so many ORs, et cetera. So those kind of things are very specifically prioritized. And there's a long list, actually, and every hospital has that.
And along the lines of the protocols, even in terms of the lessons we learned from Hurricane Katrina, or even in response, you know, the when you have the immediate response to a situation, there's a lot of triage that takes place. And how do you deal with the situation? Even the earthquake in Haiti, there are firefighters or physicians that have gone that said that it was very difficult to triage an area where you may hear a voice, but then you have a building that's collapsing. Are you going to risk going into it? Or even some of the pets actually apparently are trained so much so that they may fear or sense, you know, so they followed certain protocols and they're in terms of their training as well. So training is important. Protocols are definitely important to follow, even in terms of the special needs population. There are, going back to the patient's rights and HIPAA, there are certain protected information, you know, with and protocols that are in place when it comes to emergencies. If you had to really deal with special needs, the disabilities, as well as children.
And those protocols, by the way, are probabilistic. You might actually get the wrong answer depending on what you've done, but it's the best we've got. In other words, someone says, I think this patient's not going to survive and this one will if I devote my time there. Well, you might have been mistaken. Yeah. The protocol doesn't require you to be infallible. In the context of Zika, though...
Yeah, but that's what I'm looking for. I'm looking for my physician to be infallible.
And you want,
I'm looking
no,
for the hospital, institution
Henry,
and the provider to be infallible,
you want your
too.
Physician to be loyal to you and not... Right. So the great challenge
First
for public health is we talk about individual patient rights and we celebrate them, but when those rights bump up against the health, I have the right, for example, to privacy, unless I'm coughing on you with tuberculosis, right? That ebb and flow of individual rights against public duty is one that we is a great
That's
challenge.
That's exactly what I'm trying to get at with this show, right?
You just succeeded.
I'm really trying to understand, again, you know, the conflict there between two competing goods, the individual rights on the one hand, the patient rights on the other, you know, that. And then again, what's owed to the general public and the healthcare provider?
If this is your physician, what I think everyone in medicine would agree is that her duty is to her patient.
Right, to her
patient. Want someone beside her to say, you know something, he doesn't look so good. You better devote your resources
right.
to her.
Right.
We want our doctors and nurses to be loyal to their patients and not put them in the tight spot of having to make those tough calls. Is there a ventilator available? Is there a vaccine available? Is there anybody trained with the proper protective equipment to go and see the Ebola patient? Exquisitely difficult calls that we don't want to conflict individuals with. We want a policy or a procedure or a process that may be imperfect, but which actually captures both of the values that we're trying to balance. The right of individuals to hope their doctors and patients are loyal to them, but the system's duty to try and save as many lives as possible. You want to save a lot of lives right now, by the way, then do up more money for rapid Zika testing, right?
Yeah, for women who are not pregnant.
Well, for anybody who fears they've been exposed.
And for men, yes.
Actually,
too.
I attended a panel at NSU, which actually was attended by some public health officials, as well as representative from the University of Miami, Memorial. There was really collaboration between, you know, different healthcare institutions who came on the table to discuss the allocation, even the bill that was being discussed at the time and the funding that was available or that we tried to get quickly available to the CDC as well as the states in order to tackle the problem. And so collaboration as well as education and efficient communication is very key in this current problem of Zika. We talk about asymptomatic. Now in the hospital setting, mm-hmm. patients are coming a lot of times to the ER with symptoms. Mm-hmm. You have flu-like symptoms. We're right in the middle of the flu season. Mm-hmm. But the symptoms of Zika, which are the most common, fever, rash, conjunctivitis or red eyes, joint. If you have joint pain or any type of joint pain and fever, these are such common symptoms that most patients may go to get an over-the-counter, over-the-counter and treat their symptoms. And as a primary care physician, before a lot of patients come to us when they're sick. And that's where the difference between an epidemic like Ebola or, you know, a public health emergency that involves really ill people, even dying quickly, where coming in to an ER setting, to the hospital setting for care, and stratifying between patients that need care or not based on their current presentation in order to save lives. And then you have another entity, which I call a silent epidemic. Zika is actually a silent congenital problem, because then a year from now, we will be faced with currently, as of November 3rd, there are 131 pregnant women in the state of Florida being monitored for possible Zika, and where you get the fetal ultrasounds. And these are women that have been tested. Yeah. And for privacy purposes, going back to the privacy, the state have opted not to reveal which counties that these women are, but just giving the overall numbers for the state of Florida. So asymptomatic patients are not coming to us. We have a responsibility to educate and prevent this illness.
Illness, no, I totally get it. We're out of time, believe it or not. So we're going to have to continue this online or possibly with another show. But thank you for taking the time. I'm Henry Mack. Thanks for watching and tuning in to Viewpoint. Viewpoint is made possible by the generous financial support from the Greenlight Fund. For more information, call 305-424-4191.